Thank you very much, sir. And the topic given to me is that how do you actually plug infrastructure gaps in the clusters? And you know, when we talk about the cluster common infrastructure, and we have these the physical infrastructure, the technology infrastructure, marketing infrastructure, categories of infrastructure that exist in a cluster to become competitive. In addition to hard infrastructure, there is also soft infrastructure, primarily the manpower development. Conventionally, the approaches have been not-for-profit. Cluster development in India has been not-for-profit, focusing on soft inputs in terms of trainings, association, capacity building. In India, now we have moved significantly forward in terms of creating a business case for cluster development. It's not just for not-for-profit where we organize some workshops, seminars, and disseminate information, do capacity building, which is very, very important. I would call the softer inputs, association building, capacity building, as the foundation for a building, foundation of a building. Without foundation, there can't be a building. But the ones which are critical common infrastructure, marketing, credit related to that, it's like a superstructure. Without foundation, superstructure cannot exist. Only with foundation, if there is no superstructure, you can't go and you can't use it. So both are equally important, and it has to start with the foundation and go to the superstructure. And how we created that is the model that I will be sharing with you. And infrastructure development, when we say, and typically we operate in different, in isolation, conventionally, in India or any other developing country, government pursues its own agenda, banks would look at only sustainable, bankable projects to be funded. MSMEs, there is a need, there is a willingness, but difficult to articulate, difficult to come together. So therefore, we require someone to facilitate program management support and a PPP model who would have a commercial interest as well of creating an ecosystem and managing. The whole approach is now creating ecosystem. For creating this ecosystem, there has to be ecosystem facilitator. And facilitator, manager, you need to have someone who will be able to build a project, work with all the stakeholders together from concept to commissioning basis. And we, infrastructure leasing and financial services, we have set up a separate unit called Cluster Development Initiative. We play that role of facilitating the ecosystem management, right from hard intervention to soft interventions. And within, when we say clusters, addressing the critical infrastructure, conventionally we see, look at only common facility centers in industrial estate. Let's say Jaipur you are going tomorrow for your site visit. Jaipur has several industrial estates. Within an existing industrial estate, road is not good enough. If a common facility center is not good enough, and working on improving it is filling the gaps in the existing cluster. But creating completely new induced cluster, in the sense, separately industrial park, industrial cluster being created is also kind of addressing the critical infrastructure gaps. How we went about create induced clusters? When you say induced clusters, an industrial estate, quote unquote, loosely saying industrial estate, owned and driven by the users, and which has the entire value chain, supply chain within that limited boundaries of the thing. There is a huge process, right, from identification till it is operation and maintenance. There are several steps in that. So the slide that I mentioned initially, this one, involving all those people, and with the program management and facilitation, what is required is one has to go through this, right, from which cluster, what are the gaps there, how do we address, does it require a new park, does it require a flint treatment plan, marketing center, identification, creating a business plan, and structuring a legal entity which will own and drive, because cluster concept, ultimately the principle of clustering is the ownership to drive, own and drive that initiative should lie with user enterprises. Government should act as a facilitator. So if that is the case, we need to bring them into an organized structure, establishment of SPV, Special Purpose Vehicle Company. They require land. Land is an important thing, whether you want to set up a small training center or industrial estate, land is an issue. From there, the financial closure and estimations, execution, staffing, and whole thing to become operational, this program manager, the stakeholders need to work together in a business plan, right from identification to completion, and beyond completion, operation maintenance. Have you done this in India? Yes. I will share some of those examples here. At the center of this is Special Purpose Vehicle Company. The topic is on ecosystem. If you look at Special Purpose Vehicle Company, SPV, it's a company established by the user enterprises to own and operate a common infrastructure facility. It could be an industrial park, an effluent treatment plant, a marketing center, or a training center. And all these stakeholders are bonded together through structured, legal, and committed agreements. It's not a loose commitment. There is a financial, monetary commitment or a legal commitment to do this. Why infrastructure is, this is the most conflict neutral. Everybody needs water, everybody needs road, everybody needs workspace to operate. Therefore, bring them together. That's the starting point. And on that, then the skill development kind of software service load. Then it could then common business operate. It could create a brand involving all of them. You could actually have common marketing facilitation. But infrastructure starting is a very good way of bringing these guys together to operate. So therefore, greenfield industrial parks, we have done close to about 100 food processing, textiles, leather, engineering, and all that. I will share some of those cases here. This is a handloom, the homemade handloom workers, and for that industry, they're being brought together for the first time probably in the world of corporatizing. In a sense, this is a home-based work, highly decentralized. Somebody does the preparatory work, somebody does weaving, somebody does something, but all these activities being brought under one roof in a corporatized format, but the ownership is still with the weavers. And it is done in about 23 acres near Hyderabad. These are the activities from weaving, preparatory, processing, made-ups, beautification, stitching is there. And this is how the parks look like. Some of those brilliant kind of impact that, some of you have seen how handlooms are done in India. Dingy, very dark room inside their house, no electricity, and then very difficult to look at and stitch. Entire family would be working. The effluent is right next to the kitchen because there's no effluent treatment facility. You just dip it and dry. The whole environment is difficult. Any buyer of Fab India, for that matter, any of those want to buy some 1,000 pieces of similar kind of fabric material, you will not get because there is no scale. Each one does only 10. And 20 people will have to do that scale. There is batch variation, quality, several issues. This addresses all that. You have a very nicely designed, by creating a family environment, the building is created, and you look at all these kind of facilities. They come, family comes and operate, and you have a processing unit, integrated dyeing unit has been set up, a training center. See, there is a huge technology upgradation from a traditional loom to the semi-mechanized loom. The kind of dyeing which they used to do with this, then it has been taken to the cabinet dyeing. Similarly, every process has been modernized, because in a handloom industry, that's central to that. So from the loom to technology, all that. That is what we have done in handlooms. But one bitter lesson we learnt out of handlooms. This park. That is, you cannot treat a handloom cluster, handloom industry, in the similar fashion the way you treat a spinning or mechanized weaving industry. This requires special treatment in terms of higher allocation of government support. For example, any industrial park, today, Government of India, Ministry of Textiles has a scheme where some users, if the textile industry users come together, set up a textile park and own it and run it, they give 40% cost of the buildings, irrespective of whether they're hand looms or power looms or spinning. But our experience here is that with 40% of the support for buildings, handloom industry, handloom cluster cannot be viable. It requires higher level of support. So now we are trying to rework out and adjust this, but this is right at the bottom of the value chain of textile industry of the Pochampalli. Then another one in Tamil Nadu near Coimbatore, this is for power looms. It's about roughly about $10 million, and there is a Government of India grant for the common infrastructure. Rest of the money has been put in by the users in terms of their own equity and term loans. There are 90 units and 74 of them are operational. And this is how it looks like. And this is a small industry. Otherwise, these are all operating out of their kind of cow sheds next to the kitchen. Now they come here and set up each one into a unit and they own the common infrastructure. Look at how traditionally this kind of loom. But in this ready-to-use kind of building, the flooring to humidification, the whole thing is very, very conducive. And any foreign buyer can come, it will pass the compliances related to that buy. In other words, enhancing its compliance level and competitive. This is the entrance, this is a training center, there is a training institute which is there. This, you see the difference between conventionally how they do it and what is being done here. The third level is very high-end. This is meant for Victoria's Secret. They supply the lingerie to Victoria's Secret based on knitwear theme, a new, completely new industrial park, first FDI in India, has been set up in 1,000 acres and $1 billion investment. When, say, 4, 8, 7, 8, those days we used to be happy situation of $1 billion there, and 60,000 jobs to be created, and but 17 units, very large scale. This is what it is. It's a fiber to kind of store, and you'll have right from the fabric manufacturing, garmenting, buttons, elastics, printing, embroidery, labels, everything is done under this. All these which are shown are actually operational. It's not on theory. So today, out of 60,000 people, this is how it looks like. And the first air-conditioned factory in India, very massive, 100,000 square feet of thing under one roof. This is how you look at knitting, processing, weaving. And these are the ones, elastic manufacturing. This is the buttons, clothing. It has a huge infrastructure that would 60 million liters per day. And the effluent is treated to international standards and then disposed into sea through 8-kilometer pipeline. A lot of investment has gone into this. And look at this. This is treated. One of the biggest factors of textile industry is effluent treatment. So they have a common effluent treatment where it is treated and, as I said, discharged after treatment to sea through 8 kilometers. The third-party surveillance, government institutions, independent technical institutions. I think this is a classic case, this part of the world, where you could create truly world-class, induced new cluster, everything within that boundary of this. And we have been associated with all of them. In it has housing for managers to workers to recreational facilities, whole kinds of stuff. So this is at the highest level. So I mentioned about the handloom, then the power loom, then next level. This one is the integrated, a composite kind of thing. In addition to creating new clusters, what we could do here in India, also, elsewhere also, setting up of common, upgrading the existing infrastructure, setting up of common facilities to be done. And this is a Kanpur BDS program, which SIDBI, we did some time back. And the very classic case of upgrading the existing real estate is this in Gujarat, Vatva, of 100 crore. It's part funded by government grant. But very important is that we created the property taxes being paid by these industrial estate users, which is within city to municipality, has been escrowed. Against that escrow amount, we arranged loan. Because this requires significant amount of investment of 100 crore. Government grant was only about 40% of that. 60% has to be raised. Users have put in as equity 20%, 40% loan. But who will give loan to an association? Which bank would give? But then the municipal corporation came forward saying that, look, whatever property taxes these guys are paying into municipal corporation, we will put them in escrow account. Against that, you take the loan. Then the loan was arranged. Very innovative kind of instrument that we engineered. 2,200 chemical and engineering SMEs, 100,000 jobs that they provide, and see the impact. The roads used to be on this left, and after this upgradation is done, how the roads look like. The drainage, the water supply, the whole thing has been revamped in that industrial estate. Very, very classic case of public-private partnerships, industrial association cluster taking the ownership. Similarly, in Tripura, in northeastern part of the country, the handicraft bamboo weavers, and how we created the common facilities there, farm to market concept, and introduced the mechanization, the capacity building institution around these common facility centers. It's meant for livelihood clusters. Otherwise, based on bamboo, they were only splitting the bamboo and selling it. They were not adding value. And for the first time, we brought in value addition where they actually do it. Incomes increased by 3 times. Very, very significant level of improvements have been done. The other last point that I would like to make is that, well, this is important. For clusters, SMEs to grow, one of the important infrastructure elements is soft infrastructure, that being the manpower. How do you actually address the quality skills of the manpower? We in Ireland FS, we have a program called Spring Skills Program for Inclusive Growth, where we train the youth for jobs. It's a placement-linked program. We've done about 300,000 people so far, last 6 years. If you see that, textile, apparel, leather, engineering, construction, which is essentially the manufacturing sector thing, a large number. And 50% of them are girls, about more than two-thirds are below 10th, and more than two-thirds are scheduled tribe, scheduled caste. So, which is highly gender impact and very, very useful for the community as well as to the industry because they get the trained manpower. Very scientific way of doing it. First, we identify jobs, go to the community, tell them where the jobs are, and integrate assessment, training, assessment, certification, placement. This is best illustrated by a case study done by McKinsey. McKinsey went around globally as a part of their research, education to employment. They identified two best global case studies on this, and Island FS work that was done was one of them. I'll just share that small clipping with you. Volume.
Many systems are failing youth and they are failing employers.
Even though everyone agrees that education to employment is absolutely critical, there's a significant lack of data in terms of the journey from education to employment and how it breaks down along the way.
We have very good quality infrastructure, we have very good quality of machinery, and we got finance, but where are the people?
Many of the stakeholders work on parallel tracks on the issues that are in front of them and don't recognize the critical importance of seeing it as a system.
Industry requires work skills, and our education system doesn't provide those work skills.
We were struggling to find the skilled labor that could work in the plants.
I realized I need to do something better with my life.
In order to get an understanding of what's happening, we did a survey of 4,500 youth, 2,700 employers, and 900 education providers across 9 countries. 40% of employers report that skills are a main driver of entry-level job vacancies. Young people are 3 times more likely than their parents to be out of work. We have seen successful examples of education to employment. As part of our research, we profiled over 100 cases across 25 countries.
Education and skills were seen as a state responsibility, but the execution was in the private sector. And when you looked at the NGO space, they had trust and execution skills, but they did not have the ability to scale.
We don't go for a certificate, we're going for a job. So we get the employer to get involved in making sure that the skills program that we are running with these people meets exactly their requirement.
They need to do these things with their hands. So the best way of teaching them is through audio-visual demonstration. So we have an expert operator on camera who is actually demonstrating each of those tasks.
We looked at how do you put technology into the value chain, the skill training value chain. With the IKEA, you just switch it on and the student gets transformed into classroom. I think we built a very good standardized, scalable model of training. Whether it's in the northern part of India or southern or any other parts of India, it's standardized and it's delivered to quality, which is what the industry needs.
I never thought that I would get such a good job that, you know, I always wanted to work in a 5-star hotel. To be in that position, a person needs to have a degree of 3 years and has to have an experience of 2 years. But just the things that I learned in 1 month was enough to get that job in my hand.
We ensure that we are at each intersection, in some way we own that intersection. We're actually improving the competitiveness of the industry, which is again a big thing in terms of employment. So I think there couldn't be a much better nation-building activity than skill development.
Too many youth get lost along the way. They deserve a better chance for success.
I am AC technician.
I am a retail sales associate.
I am sewing machine operator.
I am a healthcare assistant.
So thank you very much, and briefly about what we do, Island FS, from infrastructure to financing to marketing, capacity building to training, and the Cluster Development Initiative Group, which I head with an Island FS group, is responsible. We are owned by government financial institutions and other institutions. It's not a promoter driven. It's a company promoted by institutions to work with the industry, financing and developing, operating the projects. So I won't bore you with what we do. I think I've already taken enough time, and any support, anything that is required, and we are also, since some colleagues from Africa are here, and we are working in agriculture skills education 17 African countries of these, which you see here, as a part of Government of India Indo-Africa Summit Forum, we'll be very happy to extend support to other. These are the, including policy advisory. We work very actively with the government in terms of developing policy schemes, etc. Any support that we can provide to any one of you, kindly feel free to mail me on this. And my colleague is here, Punita, if you could stand up. And I will have to leave for another meeting after 10-15 minutes, but she will be around later on for any questions. But if there are any questions here, with your permission, sir, may I take any questions. Thank you very much. If there are any questions, I can take the questions. Yeah, please, the lady there. And incidentally, tomorrow I understand you are going to Jaipur for a block printing cluster and hand block printing cluster. That's also one of our projects where we advise them. And you will see an excellent common effluent treatment plant that has been set up, part funded by you. GIZ was also supportive of that project. And how it changed the block printing industry future, you will see for yourself. Otherwise, it was under High Court order. Industry was on threat of closure. And about 50 acres of land was taken. Each one had set up a block printing unit, done to an international standard, and supported by the environment infrastructure. And we'll be very happy tomorrow when you're going around to show you that project as well. Yeah, please, ma'am.
Thank you for the presentation. My name is Priyam. I'm from the World Bank, and very interesting points that you raised. I wanted to raise a question on the induced cluster approach. There are as many examples that have worked and as many that have failed, where we take a supply-driven approach, you know, across institutions and countries, set up industrial parks. One of the main challenges that I've seen is how do you build that incentive for the local manufacturers and producers to relocate to the industrial park or to the induced cluster? They already have informal organizations. In your experience for ILNFS projects, how have you tapped on the political economy of those informal institutions to actually make induced clusters a success in a sustainable way? So if you can share your experiences.
Yeah, absolutely. Firstly, there was an interesting study done by World Bank. Since you are from the bank, you can also check up. The World Bank has done a study on this model of textile clusters, induced textile clusters, textile parks of, sorry, you were saying something? Yeah, bank has done the study, where they found this particular project, initiative of Government of India through Ministry of Textiles of setting up of textile clusters through so-called PPP mode, is successful, and it has listed several factors as to why it went into success. One of them is the size. See, unfortunately, many Government of India programs, or for that matter, any other government would stipulate, so it has to be minimum of this size, it has to meet, but here it's open-ended. It's up to the users to come together and then set up the park. Example, we have 10 acres of park done by the smallest of the weavers in one location to 1,000 acres. It depends on the users, their felt needs, how they articulate the business plan. End of the day, sigma of all those initiatives has to make sense. So that flexibility is one. Second is, as I mentioned, that the program manager concept, someone who will work with the industry, the government, the banks, technical institutions together, concept to commissioning, you need to have a commercial facilitator, the role played by ILNFS. And right from the beginning, as we speak, in fact, 11 o'clock meeting which I am rushing for is also that related to that particular project, because 2-3 projects are slightly in difficulties and we are trying to restructure the debt and all that stuff. This is sixth year. We have been there with them, 3 years it was operational, but we continue to handhold even 3 years after they became operational. I think the credit goes to Government of India with that vision of bringing an institution who will handhold, just not put a DPR or appraisal and take their money and go, but link their future with the future of the park. That's another important. Third is the informal networks that you mentioned is actually the cornerstone of the success of these parks. I'll give an example of informal networks. Like the Pochampally Park, I've seen, why is that we were able to bring them together? I was in the Ministry of Textiles, I was Joint Textile Commissioner, Textiles Committee Secretary. That time we started something called Geographical Indication Act came. It was very, very new in India. It was in 2002 or so. Pochampally cluster was the first GI branded product of handlooms Pochampalli, Ikat, they do the tie and dye product. Tie and dye in that area of 100 villages in the district have been declared as geographically under GA, sort of patent, that any product made here can carry Ikat, particular district. There was a network that was available. There were about 40 master weavers who were there, who are working together in terms of this. Then the same network, we used them, we worked with them, saying that, look, this is one stage you did, but you still can't supply some 10,000 meters of fabric, which is defect-free, consistent quality, to any exporter. Can you? You can't. On the other hand, your competitiveness is going down. You have the power looms who are imitating yours, but unless you actually come up with something which will move up the value chain, you will not be able to survive. Once they saw the reason, we facilitated them, brought them together, and they were the ones who invested the first 10% in the equity of the textile park. They were the ones who have put in first the $200,000 that was required to make the project. They were the ones who bought the land because they saw the purpose. Then the government built on that. It is not the government which went around and bought the land and gave it to them, gave them money. It was their initiative. Why they saw the reason? They say this. I strongly believe any informal network, say is the case that Palladam, Coimbatore, was done by Palladam Powerloom Industry Association. There was an association existed. But the association, my opinion is that can be inspired to see a larger business purpose, mutually beneficial, beyond lobbying. Today associations are seen it only before the budget. They give some requests for the tax exemptions, XYZ. But if you are able to articulate a common business plan that goes beyond these informal networks, be the associations, groups, will respond beautifully. That's our this thing. Out of 40 textile parks that we have done, and 22 of them are based on informal networks or the associations earlier. And some of them, like Palladam, is success story, really success story. Their repayments to the banks have been 100% right, not even a single day default. They increased their turnovers, they increased their profitability, everything. And it was possible because of that Palladam Powerloom Association and association leader and one Mr. Senthil Kumar, who stood there. Therefore, in my first slide, I said, the soft inputs, association building, capacity building is like foundation. You lay the foundation, then you bring in rest. Without that, we have seen some other parts, without that soft social capital being there, we brought these guys together, they fell apart within just 2 years and projects had to be abandoned. Because there was no common shared social capital. Informal networks do provide that.
Thank you, Mr. Reddy. I think we will stop the question now because we have 3-4 presentations. I think we will get some answer during presentation also. If still something is left, we can tackle it a little later. Thank you, Mr. Reddy.